idea confirmed by most of the diabetes is possible on scale. The guideline shows the average blood sugar level in patients receiving standard diabetes care over 2 years. The light blue line shows the average sugar level of diabetic patients on a low carb diet, and you can clearly see that those receiving standard diabetic care have significantly higher blood sugar levels over the 2 year period. In fact, at 2 years, 53% of the patients on a low carb diet met the criteria for diabetes reversal. Now, given that most of the glucose in our circulation on the back of the upper arm and has a small painless needle which senses glucose levels. And it communicates wirelessly with a smartphone or a dedicated reader device and provides 24-hour real-time blood sugar monitoring. And this is a readout from a continuous glucose monitor from one of my patients the day before starting the diet. And a couple of days later, you can see the vast improvements in the stability of sugar levels. And this kind of stability is even more important than the absolute level because it's the variations in the blood sugar levels which also generate significant amounts of oxidative stress, which, as we'll soon see, causes problems in the cell. And I do recommend these monitors to a lot of patients, to anybody who's curious about their personal blood sugar response to specific foods. And it's also about compliance. You can't pretend that something is okay. Now, shift gears and have a look at processed foods. And processed foods actually now make up more than half of the consumed dietary energy in most westernized countries, home countries. Now, despite often being disguised behind packaging making various health claims, they're really not that good. And when I think about processed foods, I think and vegetable oils, or more correctly, seed oils. Let's start with sugar. Now, sugar or sucrose is a problem because it contains exactly 50%, in fact, which is very comparable to the amount of sugar in high fructose corn syrup. So we don't get away with it in Australia. And the first problem is that fructose is very important, even compared to glucose. So fructose is actually about 2.5%. And this means is involved in both pausing this process and continuing this cycle. Fructose consumption also leads to much more fat production. Remember that de novo lipogenesis? Well, as we know, in a metabolically healthy state, most of the glucose and only about 20% will actually contribute to de novo lipogenesis. Fructose has no capacity to be stored. All the fructose vegetable oil. Why? I don't know. But reducing the oxidative stress, which reduces the damage to the stomach acid and the membrane and the fermentation level. And this is exactly what we see. So in this recent study, low carb and high carbohydrate diets, we can see that the low carb intervention actually has significantly higher levels of plasma stomach acid than the high carb diet. You can see that the percentage of people with biopsy proven liver disease after 7 years of treatment therapy was about 60%. And this trend shows no signs of stopping. And in fact, several patients died of liver disease over the course of this study. So clearly, the ingestion of oxidized vegetable oils is probably not good for the liver. You know what could be worse though? The consumption of oxidized oils if you're a poorly controlled diabetic. This bar represents the degree of oxidation products absorbed into whole microns following the meal of oxidized corn oil in a healthy subjects. This bar here, the same degree of oxidized corn oil in well-controlled type 2 diabetics, and if you're poorly controlled type 2 diabetics, then all goes to And this is why controlled blood sugar is so important. If you're a poorly controlled diabetic consuming vegetable oils, you're on a hiding to nothing. So then what's new? Well, first of all, keep your blood sugar level low. And get your polyunsaturated fats and fresh food. So long as the food you're eating is not rancid, which is actually the definition of food. Now, some of you will have heard all of this, and you're still becoming comfortable with the idea of being saturated fat. Well, this prospective study looked at more than 135,000 participants and followed them for 7 years and looked at saturated fat consumption and mortality rates. And it found that those habitually consuming about 10% of their calories from saturated fat, not much, had a death rate of about 7 people for every 1,000 person years. But in those who were consuming more than 3 times as much saturated fat, the equivalent death rate was only 4. And there was no upper level of saturated fat intake which appeared problematic. As energy from saturated fat increased, so too did the benefits. And yes, I know that saturated fat can increase LDL cholesterol. And no, that doesn't matter either. This systematic review from 2016 looked at 19 cohort studies with over 68,000 participants. And of those 19 studies, 16 of them found an inverse relationship between the level of LDL cholesterol and risk of mortality. That is, the higher the LDL level, the lower the risk of dying. And 14 of those studies reached statistical significance, meaning this finding was very unlikely to be true. So, remember that obesity is reversible. Diabetes is reversible. All you have to do is avoid vegetable oils and embrace saturated fat. A pretty simple recipe. So I'd also like to offer a special thanks to Dr. T who shared the journey in the hope that it might help others. If you're a doctor, please be open to the possibility that what you learned in medical school may be wrong. And if your patients come to you wanting to try, process, I'd like you to take away a few things. Firstly, we want to debunk the calories in, calories out, low-fat hypothesis of weight loss. I want to demonstrate to you that a low-carbohydrate diet is actually good for longevity. People live longer when they eat low-carbohydrate, and sugar, because of fructose, has some particularly unique and toxic effects on the body. So to begin our journey, I'd like to introduce you to one of my patients. Now, this is the kind of patient that, as a doctor, I love. She was very, very compliant. So she first came to my clinic with joint pain, and she was overweight. And it was very clear to both of us that if she could lose some weight, that would help her condition. So we had a conversation and started talking about her existing attempts to lose weight. And it seemed that she had a very conventional approach, the kind that's recommended by most doctors, eat low fat. So let's hear her recount this in her own words.
When I was doing full of low fat, you would have seen my fridge, which is full of low fat cheese. No oil touched any fry pan in my kitchen. All of the meat was as lean as you could possibly get. And I ate salad and I was starving all the time.
And were you exercising?
Oh, madly, 6 days a week. And I was doing those classes. I was doing back-to-back classes, so an hour of HIIT class and followed by a pump class, and 6 days a week. So, and then I felt really guilty on the 7th day because I wasn't exercising.
So, she was following the conventional advice. She
She was slavishly following that advice. She was exercising, she was eating like that, but the trouble is it was not working. At the time she saw me, she was 30 kilograms overweight and gaining. So when I'm faced with this scenario as a doctor, I have to ask myself, who is responsible? Who is to blame? So the patient's following the medical advice that they've been given. So is it the patient? Or is it the doctor or the medical professional who gave the advice? So I would argue the blame should actually lie with the doctor or the health professional. Because the implications of the advice is that you fail to lose weight, you're lazy, and you're just not trying hard enough. But this very point overlooks the key essence to understanding weight loss, and that's hormones. The conventional calories in, calories out hypothesis ignores the effect of hormones. A very strong science. So we've got a lady here, she's 35 years old, and she's got a problem with a hormone called cortisol. And she's just been gaining weight. And this is what happens when her hormone problem was treated. She didn't get given advice to exercise more, she didn't get told to eat less. We fixed the hormone problem, and the weight problem goes away. This boy here, 3 years old, he weighs 42 kilograms, and he's got a problem with a hormone called leptin. 7 years old, he now weighs 10 kilograms lighter at a very healthy weight. See what happens when you fix the hormone problem? Now, the most common hormone in the population that causes obesity is not one of those. It's called insulin. And this lady has a problem with insulin, but she's got a real problem. She's got a tumor in her pancreas that secretes insulin and pumps it into her circulation. In this picture, she's 107 kilograms and she's only 152 centimeters tall. So she had a new picture which lowered the insulin levels in her body. Now, these photos were taken 50 days apart. Her weight dropped to 89 kilograms. She lost 18 kilograms. And if we have a look at a graph of her weight loss, you can see that in a 10-day period, she lost 14 kilograms. So clearly there's a problem here with insulin that makes you fat. Now, this patient also had a problem with insulin. This was one of my patients. You can see her here, 46 years old and a size 20. This is what happened when we fixed her insulin problem. She lost 40 kilograms, and here she is about a size 8. The big difference is she didn't have surgery to fix her insulin problem. We changed her diet. So you're probably asking, how on God's green earth can a diet lead to such dramatic changes in your insulin problem? This is a graph here, and the height of the lines there represents how much insulin your body's releasing. And each of those individual lines represents one of the three main sources of energy in our diet: carbohydrates, protein, or fat. So let's have a look at carbohydrates. Let's see what happens when you eat carbohydrates in your insulin levels. This is called the area under the curve. You get a massive and prolonged release of insulin for over 2 hours. Let's have a look when you have the same amount of energy contained within protein, much less. And the surprising thing for many people, that is even less. So think about that for a moment. High levels of insulin are associated with obesity, and carbohydrates are the most potent stimulus we have for our bodies to release insulin. So in order for us to lose weight, we need to control our insulin level, ergo, we need to control our carbohydrate intake. Now, we can broadly classify diets into one of two groups. On the left here, we have what's called low carbohydrate diets. And on the right, we have low fat diets, which tend to be high in carbohydrate because the energy has to come from somewhere. So let's have a look, an unbiased look at the evidence, comparing these two types of diets in terms of weight loss. Between 2003 and 2018, there were 62 published randomized controlled trials comparing low carbohydrate diets, less than 130 grams a day, to low fat diets in terms of weight loss. 31 of these studies had statistically significant findings. What that means is that the results were not likely due to chance. You could probably trust them. So what I've done here is I've graphed these 31 studies that had statistically significant findings, no therapeutic year at all, and I've compared the average weight loss on the both diets. The low carbohydrate diet is depicted in blue, and the low fat diet is depicted in red. And you'll note that in every single one of these studies that we've got here, the low carbohydrate diet led to more weight loss than a low fat diet. So the question is, which horse would you back? Let's change pace a little bit and see exactly how insulin makes fat tissue grow. Because if we understand this, we can understand the cause of the disease. By the time you're 2 years old, you've got every fat cell that you're likely to have. So if you gain weight after the age of 2, it's because your fat cells have gotten bigger, not because of your diet. So if we can work out what makes an individual fat cell bigger, then we can determine what makes you fat. So what I'd like to demonstrate here is that you can see how the circulation of these blood vessels are intimately related to each and every fat cell. Now we understand that hormone is released into the circulation, and because of this relationship with the blood vessels, it can be delivered to each and every fat cell in our body. And these blood vessels also contain fat called triglycerides. You can see here in these wiggly line depictions down there. So what happens to gain weight is that these triglycerides get transported into the fat cell and the fat cell gets bigger. The problem is this triglyceride molecule is very big. It's composed of 4 different parts. You've got this glycerol backbone, and then you've got 3 separate fatty acids. And as a whole, this molecule cannot enter into a fat cell. It has to be snipped up first. And that's where insulin comes in. So what you can see in the left-hand side, we see the triglyceride molecule, and then it's being converted to glycerol and fatty acids, being snipped up. And the LPL stands for lipoprotein lipase. This is an enzyme that is stimulated to act by insulin. And then once the fatty acids have been released, they're able to cross and store fat. Without insulin to activate lipoprotein lipase, you can't store fat. And if we have a look on the top there, you can see glucose can also enter fat cells. And it does this through a little doorway or a transporter. So for a final proof that insulin causes weight gain, let's have a look at what happens to people who habitually eat what they suffer with insulin. The one who was slavishly following the low fat exercise advice before she was born. And by doing that, she fixed her insulin problem. And then 3 years later, she'd maintained a loss of 36 kilograms and she was 28 centimetres off. And these are her actual photos. So let's have a look. What is it about carbohydrate? Happens mainly at the muscle and the liver tissue. So they stop taking it.